Returns in a moment here on TNN.
You want a man with the slow hand. You want a lover with the easy hand. You want somebody who will spend some time, not come and go in a heat.
By the mid-80s, Conway had parted ways with Owen Bradley and had started to explore the boundaries between country and pop music in his own distinctive style.
He liked sexy songs, you know? And I loved Conway, but I didn't love every song he did, you know? Some of them made even me blush, you know?
But he continued to wow his fans, particularly the ladies.
I mean, it just seemed to come natural to him because he never really talked a lot to the audience or whatever. But he'd stand there and get that head down and sing, and that girl's like, ah, you know. And I had to follow him. Old fat me, you know.
Believe me, I understand. When it comes to love, you want a slow hand. You want a lover with an easy touch. You want somebody who will spend some time with you, baby. Not come and go in the heated rush.
He always really thought about the housewives, the ladies. You know, he wrote songs pretty much for them to enjoy, whether it was sad or happy or sexy or whatever it was. He sang to the ladies, wrote for them, and performed for them. And the guys liked him also because he was a talented, good person.
In 1977, a woman by the name of Dee Henry was hired to work in Conway's office. After his divorce from Mickey, Conway and Dee began to date. They gradually fell in love and married in 1987.
You couldn't not love him. He told me one time, he said, I love you so many ways, so many different ways that you'll have to like one of them. And I think that was true. I liked them all.
Family and friends noticed a real change in Conway after he got together with Dee.
I never seen him be more at ease and more happy and with himself and other people around him, with his business, his personal life, everything than he was when he was with my stepmother, Dee.
He never had an enjoyable side to his life until Dee. He never did. He just worked all the time. But he told me, he said, Dee makes me happy, and anything I can do to make her happy, I'm gonna do it.
He found love. He found true love. He found somebody who was a real soulmate. Dee was not just wife. They were together all the time. She traveled with him. She was in the studio with him. She was in the business with him. I mean, every part of their beings were intertwined in a real profound and special way.
Off stage, Conway and Dee shied away from the limelight.
We didn't do parties. We're not politically motivated. About the only party I can ever remember us doing, we went to Vince Gill's first number one party. And then Conway was able to participate in a Vince Gill basketball game one year, a charity event. And they asked him to help present Vince with his first gold album, which was a real special thing, since Vince had been working with us as a background singer on some of our albums. But no, we weren't glamorous at all. I mean, what you see is what you got, and that was just two real normal people.
Conway had the love of his wife, his family, his friends, his fans. But during his long career, he was snubbed by the Country Music Association. He and Loretta were selected as Duo of the Year four times. But while Conway had more hits than anyone, he never received any individual honors for songwriting or performing. Though repeatedly nominated for Entertainer of the Year, he was always shut out.
He'd say, I'm the Susan Lucci of country music, but that's okay, because people like me. And the applause from the crowd when I walk on stage and that standing ovation that I get night after night, those are my awards. And he truly meant that. It never bothered him. It bothered the rest of us, but it never bothered him.
You want somebody who will spend some time.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment on TNN.
And as I taste your tender kisses, I can tell you've never been this far before.
Conway's classics to his latest hits.
That's my job.
It's Conway's most complete collection ever, but it's not sold in stores. Stay tuned to order.
To feel loved by somebody. That's the way it should be.
Call 1-800-413-5533 to save all COD charges and pay only $14.98 for cassettes or $19.98 for two CDs plus $3.50 shipping. Use your credit card or send check or money order to Conway Twitty, P.O. Box 94040, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Remember, save all COD charges by sending check or money order or use your credit card.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
Since his teen idol days, Conway rarely engaged in banter with his audience or granted interviews to the media. But during the late 80s, Conway ended his long silence.
He was so careful about his image. He didn't want to violate people's ideas of who he was. He wanted to keep it kind of mysterious and a little special, particularly through the first 20 years or so. Later in life, he kind of got a little bit more relaxed about it.
Ending his silence was typical Conway. He always knew when it was time to change.
If you look back down through the years, I mean, here's a man that had number one records in five different decades, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And you think about how music has changed from the 50s to the 90s. And for him to have number one records in every one of those different decades, he definitely knew how to change. He just rolled with the flow. When the sound changed, the business changed, he just changed right along with it.
It's a rainy night in Georgia. A rainy night in Georgia.
Always looking for a new challenge, Conway agreed to perform a duet with Sam Moore for the Rhythm, Country, and Blues Project. Sam, part of the legendary Sam and Dave duo, met Conway for the first time in the studio the day they recorded.
He just gave me this smile. We walked right in and we started talking, and we talked so much until they had to call us a couple of times. Come on, you know, this is businessy. You know, we gotta do this. A rainy night in Georgia. With us, it was a lot of love and a lot of fun. And that's the way it came off. And that was, you may say, they were faking it. It was no fake. That was real. And I always appreciate that he let me do what I do best. Man, was he great.
Conway!
The recording session took place on May 3rd, 1993. It would be Conway's last.
I've been very fortunate for 35 years. People haven't gotten tired of Conway Twitty yet, and I'm glad, because I'm sure not tired of singing yet.
I know. Oh, God.
This was one of Conway's final interviews. He was up, both professionally and personally. He never had drank. He had quit smoking, and with Dee's encouragement, had begun to exercise regularly and eat right. But on June 4th, 1993, Conway was returning to Nashville after having performed in Branson, Missouri. Earlier, he had complained of feeling a pressure in his side.
I suggested stopping at an emergency room, and he said, no, that's not necessary. It's not that bad. And I said, well, if you're no better tomorrow, we're gonna go see Dr. Van Davender. And he said, yeah, well, you know how I am. And he was somebody who took very good care of himself. He said, you know how I am. If it's not better tomorrow, we'll go see him. And then it just happened.
Conway collapsed on his tour bus from a ruptured abdominal aneurysm. He died the next day at a hospital in Springfield, Missouri. Conway Twitty was 59 years old.
He was kind of the consummate country entertainer. He looked like a country entertainer, and he had he never lost that youthful feel that he had for the music.
He was one of my greatest friends. We worked together. We had a business together. We sang together. We never had a fight. Never. Nothing that we couldn't talk about.
He always went out of his way to try to be a friend, to try to help somebody, you know. And I think that's the main thing he'd want people to remember, loving his music, loving what he did for a living, you know, because he definitely loved to do it.
He was very involved in all of our lives, and I believe we're